for you to do. And your hand is moving right now. You are still showing up at the tomb of every Lazarus. And your voice is calling. You never lost a battle. No, you never lost a battle. And I'm
So in love with you. gonna shake me.
Nothing's gonna break.
Nothing's gonna break. Nothing's gonna shake me. Ladies, now nothing's gonna break. Nothing's gonna shake me. Now nothing's gonna break. Nothing's gonna shake. Nothing's gonna break. Everybody sing. Shake me.
Sometimes I forget that I was chosen. Can't waste my life, keep my head up, gotta focus. Done floating. Where am I going? Got too high, you feel like I'm roller coasting. It's just sometimes I forget that I was chosen. Can't waste my life, keep my head up, gotta focus. Done floating. Hey, I walked in the building, I made it. Funny thing is, I'm back in the crib and it don't even feel like I made it. See Lecrae like me, my favorite. Signing these papers, I'm looking at faces I used to see on the screen, my face on the screen. Homie, welcome to the team, 116. I've been on my way until I hit the curb. Making these moves, I'm putting in work. It's been a week since I got in the word. Every day I feel like it's getting worse. Feeling the pressure to finish the verse. Losing my trust in these people, it hurts. Can't let a blessing turn into a curse. Watch the pride, put your boy in a hearse. Get a little ego.
Get a little ego.
Hobie a hero.
Hobie a hero.
Make a little hit. It's like a free throw. Yeah. I got a choice. Give him the juice or give him the coin. Go deaf trying to block out the noise. I realize I don't hear his voice. Where am I going? Got too high. You feel like I'm rollercoasting. It's just sometimes I forget that I was chosen. Can't waste my life. Keep my head up. Gotta focus. Done floating. Where am I going? Got too high. You feel like I'm it's just sometimes I forget that I was chosen. Can't waste my life, keep my head up, gotta focus. Done floating.
Who am I? Show me who am I. Going
high. Yeah.
Get
this on my chest. I feel like I lost the balance. I feel like everything in the inside leading up and it happened. They talking like Hovie on the scene, Hovie on the scene. Listen, he rapping. They don't even know about the kid, know about my soul, know about my life, know about the loss, know about the weak, know about my home.
Thank you. Hey everyone, welcome to Black Rock Student Ministry. We are so glad that you have tuned in with us tonight. We're so glad that you are just choosing to invest in your relationship with Jesus, and that's an awesome thing. So I'm just saying, glad you're here. But I also wanted to talk to you because, and I'm coming to you from my house because I want to just share with you that things are going to be a little bit different tonight. Normally, we love having fun, playing crazy games, doing all that, but the reality is we live in a really hard time right now. And that there have been some crazy injustices that have occurred in our country as of late. George Floyd is just one of way too many, because there should be none, way too many people, human beings, who have been killed or experienced prejudice because of what they look like. Let me just say this. That is not the heart of our Father. That we as a student ministry staff, that we want to tell you that racism is wrong at every level, in every sense. It is so wrong because that it goes against completely who God is, who Jesus is, his heartbeat. You know, for me personally, you know, I love as our group becomes more and more diverse, I love it. And the reason why I love it so much is because it reflects more of what the kingdom of God really is. A beautiful mix of these amazing people who look very different from each other, but love the same one God who created us all. One of my favorite verses is from Romans chapter 5, verse 8, and it says, "For God demonstrated his own love for us in this, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." And what that means, what that verse is saying, one of the things that it's saying is that you know what? God loves us. And in fact, he loves each and every one of us, no matter what we look like, no matter what our background is, no matter where we're coming from or what we look like. He loved us enough, loves us enough that he sent his only son to die for us. That's how much worth, how much value, how much love he has for each and every one of us. And so I know that there are some of you right now who are hurting and you're angry and you're just a whole like mess inside and you don't know what to do with that. Let me just say, bring it to Jesus. Bring it to God. They know the pain that you're feeling, the heartache that you're going through. Jesus came to overcome all of this. And so I want to encourage you, come to him. And there's some of you that are watching this and you really don't know what's going on. And maybe you haven't heard a lot about this, or maybe, and I hope this isn't the case, but maybe you just don't think it's that big of a deal. And if that's you, I really want to challenge you tonight. I want to challenge you to think about, how does Jesus feel about this situation? How does Jesus feel about someone that he has not only created, but also died for? How would he feel about that person's life being minimalized and being seen as less than or being expendable? Because that is something that Jesus would be vehemently against, because he is for us. He's demonstrated that. And guys, we, our challenge is to make sure that we are demonstrating love. Not talk, not just saying things, but doing it. And sometimes we do that poorly. But we need to demonstrate that not only to other people, but also to our Heavenly Father. And to show him that we love him by aligning our heart to his. Allowing our hearts to break for what breaks his. And so we are going to actually transition now into a time of worship. And Zach's going to sing a song, "Lord, Send Revival." And he's pulling this off today, just, you know, making this happen, because we felt like we needed to really dial in here. And for those of you who are hurting right now, guys, I want to encourage you, challenge you. Can we still worship God even when we're hurting? Even when life is hard? Is he still good? Can we worship him anyway? And for those, maybe your heart isn't stirred up as much as it should be, pray that as you worship him tonight, that he would stir within your heart a heart for revival. Because guys, what will heal our country and heal this world is ultimately Jesus. It's a spirit of God working on hearts, releasing people from the power of sin. But it's also Jesus us being the hands and feet of Jesus, us being the beautiful feet that bring good news of reconciliation between us and God, but also person to person, human being to human being. So again, to all my brothers and sisters out there who are Black, I am sorry, and I want you to know that you are loved, appreciated, and seen, and wanted so very much. You make our community better. You do. And I love that you're here with us. And I just want you to know that. And guys, before we jump into worship, I just want to pray for us as a ministry, as we move forward. So God, I just thank you that you are a God who hears the cry of the brokenhearted. That you are a God who cares about each and every individual. God, you know the very hairs upon our head. God, you know and you care about the very little details of our lives. You care about that because you have made us, because you died for us, and you desire that we would be reconciled to you because you love us so much. You want to be with us for all of eternity. And God, I pray, God, that your spirit, your people would move to bring a work of healing to this country, to this world. And God, though sin will always be present until you come again, God, I just pray that your people would push back against the enemy, against evil, and we would stand and fight for what is good, and that we would be loving towards all people at all times. God, I thank you. I thank you, God, in the midst of craziness and turmoil, that we have a Heavenly Father who is ever present, who's always loving, and is with us every step of the way. So God, thank you for who you are and for this time of worship that we're about to enter into right now. Thank you, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Peace like a river, wash over me. Immerse me in water as deep as the sea. Hide me in love, your healing embrace. A peace like a river, wash over me. As I worship your majesty, I worship your holy name. Jesus, my everything, all that I am is yours. Oh. Come on, Spirit, rain down on me. Break open the heavens and drench the earth sea. Pour out your presence as I pour out your praise. Come, Holy Spirit, as I worship your majesty, I worship your holy name. Jesus, my everything, all that I am is yours. I worship your your majesty. I worship your holy name, Jesus, my everything. All that I am is yours. All I have is yours. And open the heavens, wide the gates, flood every heart with mercy. Pour out your presence, inhabit our praise as we cry, holy, holy. Open the heavens, fling wide the gates, flood every heart with mercy. Pour out your presence, inhabit our praise as we cry, holy, holy. Open the heavens, fling wide the gates, flood every heart with mercy. Pour out your presence, inhabit our praise as we cry, holy, holy. Land like you've done it before, would you do it again? The Lord send revival, the Lord send it now. Move up your spirit, heaven break out. Come now with power, cover this land like you've done it before, would you do it again? Lord send revival, Lord send it now. A move of your spirit, heaven break out. Come now with power, cover this land like you've done it before, would you do it again? Lord send revival, Lord send it now. A move of your spirit, heaven break out. Come now with power, cover this land like you've done it before, would you do it again? Heaven break out, heaven break out, heaven break out, heaven break out. Lord send revival, Lord send it now. Move of your spirit, heaven break out. Come now with power, cover this land like you've done it before, would you do it again? Heaven break out, oh heaven. Heaven break out.
Well, hey everyone, welcome back. We're so glad that you're joining us again tonight. Man, it really feels like this year has flown by. I can't believe that after this we only have one Fusion left, one Thrive left, but I'm just glad that you guys have stuck through. I know that this time hasn't been easy, but I'm just thankful that we still get to meet together, that we still get to kind of enjoy what we typically would here at the church, but we get to enjoy it at home and still get Zoom groups to talk to each other. Now, today, I'm actually really excited because the message that God has kind of put on my heart is one that has constantly just brought me a lot of joy and really kind of reinvigorated hope into my life when I felt super hopeless, when I felt disappointed in what's going on. And I want to give you some context into the passage that we're reading tonight before we actually jump in. So the passage we're reading is actually found in Luke, and it happens the day that Jesus is resurrected. So what we typically would think of like an Easter Sunday, it happens the afternoon of that Sunday. So we're reading about two men who are leaving Jerusalem and are heading towards a town called Emmaus. So I'm going to pray, and then we're going to jump right in. So God, we thank you so much for who you are. God, we're grateful that we can still meet together, that we can still enjoy each other's presence. God, I pray that you would just speak tonight. God, that you would open our hearts to what you want to say. God, I pray that you would allow us to just stay focused on what you're saying, what you're teaching. Yeah, God, we're just excited to engage with you and in your word. So Lord, we thank you, and it's in your name we pray. Amen. Well, guys, we're going to be reading from Luke 24, verses 13 through 35. So it starts off saying, "Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, 'What are you discussing together as you walk along?' They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, 'Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?' 'What things?' he asked. 'About Jesus of Nazareth,' they replied. 'He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all of this has took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but did not find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the woman had said, but they did not see Jesus. He said to them, 'How foolish you are and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? In beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself.' As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he were going further. But they urged him strongly, 'Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sights. They asked each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?' They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them, assembled together and saying, 'It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon.' Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread." Now, for those of you guys taking notes, I've entitled this sermon "Alive Again." See, as I've thought about this passage over the past couple days, I've realized how willing I am to kind of celebrate on top of the mountain, right? When things seem to be going my way, when things seem to be going exactly how I expected them to go. Yet, when there's a turn, or when maybe God kind of leads me somewhere different, I grow super disappointed. And instead of celebrating, I'm actually complaining and walking away hopeless and just really disappointed, because what I expected wasn't what's happening. I believe that that's exactly what happens in this passage, and we kind of get to see that redeemed towards the end. But I want to talk about the beginning half of the passage first. So we start off this passage with these two men who are leaving Jerusalem and walking to Emmaus. Now, they're walking 7 miles, and I know for some of you guys watching, 7 miles like isn't a big deal. You guys can run that in your dreams. Like, you got it. You're good. But me thinking about walking 7 miles, like, that's a lot. 7 miles on average would take about 2.3 hours. I would not want to be walking for 2.3 hours. And to even add onto the situation, man, it was probably really hot, really gross. They're walking in desert weather. Yesterday, I took a walk with my dad, and when I tell you, I was like literally drenched in sweat. I hated every minute of the walk, and I think we only walked like a mile. I could not imagine walking 7 miles. Now, imagine walking 7 miles in desert heat while you're disappointed. that would probably make the walk even worse. Now, some things that we know about these men is that they were coming from Jerusalem and that they were probably celebrating Passover and that they most definitely witnessed the events of Jesus's death. Now, we don't know why they were walking to Emmaus, but we can assume that they were probably heading back home after realizing that Jesus was dead. Now, on this walk, they're discussing what happened and probably just trying to figure out where everything went wrong. And as I thought about this, I couldn't help but think about the times in my life where maybe I expected something to look one way and it kind of didn't turn out that way, and just that disappointment. And I started to ask myself, man, how often do I really just walk away from Jesus? Do I kind of step away from my faith because I'm disappointed in the outcome of something? But what's so crazy is in the midst of their disappointment, as they're walking away, we read in verse 16, that Jesus himself came up and walked along with them. But they were kept from recognizing him. Our first point for tonight is that Jesus is present in your struggle. Jesus is present in the places where you feel like he doesn't exist. And I think so often, much like these men, we're sometimes kept from recognizing Jesus in our struggle because he doesn't look the way that we think he would look. Yet he's still constant with us, constantly reminding us of who he is. And as I thought about kind of these men's interaction, their interaction with each other, but also their interaction with this stranger who comes along with them, I couldn't help but see that there was hope in them. You see, I don't know about you, but when I'm having a deep conversation with my friends, I typically don't like it when strangers try to kind of invade in that conversation. And as I was thinking about kind of times that this has happened, I couldn't help but think about in college. I thought it was always really smart to have like really deep, intimate conversations in our quad area, where literally there were three different dorms kind of surrounding this area. So I would go and tell people like, hey, let's go hang out. Let's kind of do some discipleship time where we're going to talk about Jesus. And I would always forget the reality that someone was always walking through the quad and someone always had to stop to talk, always. So they would interrupt kind of this really deep conversation. And it was always awkward because you didn't know what to do. Do you continue the conversation you're having? Or do you just kind of entertain this person and just say, you know, we'll scrap it, we'll talk about it another time. But these men invited this stranger into their conversation, invited them into what was going on. They're like, are you the only person who didn't know what was happening this past week? And I love the way that they describe Jesus because it's true. They say that Jesus was a man. He was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people. But then what we see next is their disappointment. They say, we hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. We hoped that he was the one that was going to redeem us. We hoped that it was going to turn out another way. And I think that that's really typically my response when things don't go the way that I expected. I hope that it was going to turn out this way. I hope that Jesus was going to do this one thing, and I don't see it happening, and I'm just really disappointed. But as I think about that, I think Jesus reminds us, actually Paul reminds us in Romans 8 that we are heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, provided that we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified with him. Now, I'm not saying that we must suffer the way that Jesus suffered, that you guys are going to die on a cross and kind of have to take on the sin of everybody, right? That's not what we have to do. But I believe that in order to really understand kind of who Jesus is and what he's gone through, man, we're going to suffer things in our life. And things aren't going to go the way that we assumed that they were going to go. I think sometimes it looks like us laying down our own desires, laying down our dreams and saying, God, not my will be done, but your will be done. And that can be really hard. And that can sometimes leave us disappointed for a moment. But I believe that Jesus still in that time is offering himself to us and saying, I want you to find your hope and your joy in me. And we see Jesus kind of do something in our second point for tonight would be, which is that God brings clarity, not confusion. We see Jesus actually start to clarify things for these two men who are walking. So if we look in verse 25, He says, "How foolish you are and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?" And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. Guys, Jesus begins to explain to these men who are confused about everything that's happening, who are disappointed, all the prophecies that point to the fact that he had to die. He's like walking them along and saying, "Hey, I want to come alongside you. I want you to understand what you're going through." And I believe that a lot like what Becca was talking about last week in uncertainty, man, God wants to bring you clarity. But in order to do that, guys, we have to spend time with him. And I think in spending time with him, we begin to see exactly what these two men on their walk to Emmaus see. You see, the Israelites expected Jesus to come as this like imperial ruler who was going to destroy the Romans and set them free because they had spent so many years in oppression. Yet what they get is this Jesus who is super soft-spoken, this Jesus who doesn't kind of incite violence, doesn't kind of say, "Hey, we're actually going to fight against the Romans," but yields to dying on a cross. This isn't what they expected, but it's exactly what they needed. But they needed to hear from Jesus in order to know that. Now, I know that this season of your life is not what you expected, friends. It's not what I expected either. Honestly, if you would have asked me at the beginning of 2020, if I could have predicted that we would be doing life like this, that my life would look the way that it does, constantly being home and not at church, not hanging out with you guys, I don't think I would have imagined this. And I think that there are some days that I get really, really disappointed because I want to be with you. I want to be with my friends. I want to be able to hang out with my family. But I've also had to spend a lot of time with Jesus on that. I've had to spend a lot of time with Jesus saying, "God, I expected kind of stepping into this new role with student ministry to look this way, and it doesn't look like that." And in spending time with Jesus, I've gotten to get a lot of clarity of, "Man, but this is where I want you." Because in this time, I've actually gotten to spend a lot of time being still with Jesus. You see, I realize that I like to do a lot of things, as you guys have heard before, and sometimes that comes at the sacrifice of spending time with God. And in this time, he said, "Man, you get all of this time to spend with me, all of this time to grow with me. Would you take it?" And I know that that might not seem like a lot of clarity in confusion or a lot of clarity in my disappointment, but what it's shown me is, man, where am I lacking in my own heart? And if you're honest, maybe you haven't taken this time to really sit down with Jesus and really learn and listen to him. And I think another kind of point that we see in this passage is, when do the men actually realize who they're sitting with? Who they have kind of encountered this entire time? It's not until they're sitting and they see Jesus do the same thing that he did at Passover when he broke the bread, that they're like, "Oh my gosh, like this is Jesus. This is the guy that we've been following for so long." But in order to do that, they needed to sit. They needed to be still. They needed to stop focusing on all the noise that's happening on the outside and focus on what's happening in front of them. So like Becca challenged you, man, that's a challenge for you this week. Try to spend at least 15 minutes every day to just sit with the Father. Sit with him and learn from him. Listen to his voice. Because I promise you, you'll begin to hear and begin to get clarity on what's happening in your life and how you can connect more with Jesus. Now, as we get to our last point, I want to read what happens right after they realize who Jesus is. So in verse 33, it says, "They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem, and there they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, 'It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon.' Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread." Because I believe that when we spend time with Jesus, when we spend time laying our hurt and our disappointment down at his feet, believe that he frees us from that disappointment. He frees us from that pain. But I also believe that he calls us to then go outward and tell people that he has freed us. You see, our point three for tonight, Our last point for the night is that your freedom can free others. See, instead of holding our disappointment to ourselves, instead of holding that pain to ourselves, when we lay it down at the feet of Jesus and he frees us from it, I believe that he also sends us out into the world to tell people that he's freed us. See, your friends are waiting for hope. Your friends are looking for hope. I know that my friends are. As I talk to my non-Christian friends, man, they're tired of what's going on just like I am. But there's also a question of, how do you find joy? Like, what is giving you hope in the midst of this kind of crazy thing that's happening? And I've had some of these conversations with my friends, and to be able to look back and say, well, yeah, I've just found joy in Jesus. And the hard season that this is, man, having faith, having something to hold on to has just allowed me to keep going. And I think your friends are looking for that too. You see, when I read this passage, it says that they got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. These two men didn't wait until the next day, didn't wait until like after they realized, okay, yeah, that was Jesus. Let me take time to like process that and really think about like, how do I tell other people? No, instead they return at once to Jerusalem. And I think, friends, that too often we kind of sit and wait and say, well, yeah, you know, God brought me healing, but I don't know if I want to tell other people, or I don't know if I'm ready to. But I believe that God is saying there are people who are waiting for you to spread truth and hope to them. They're waiting for you. And I think about that walk to Emmaus, right? These men are walking disappointed. They're walking away from Jerusalem, from the place where all of their friends are. Instead, now they're returning to their friends. And I can imagine, man, instead of talking about the disappointment that they're facing, they're getting to talk about the joy and the hope that they've found in Jesus. And they can't wait to share that with those who are waiting in Jerusalem. So friends, I want to challenge you. I want to challenge you this week to find ways to tell people about Jesus, to find ways to tell people about this God that has redeemed you and that has given you hope in your disappointment. And I've already gotten to hear a couple stories of how you guys are doing this. I was talking to someone just a couple weeks ago who happened to share on their Instagram story about Transform Chats. And they kind of were saying how this person that they knew, they weren't necessarily living the best life. And almost kind of this Instagram post gave them hope. And they reached out to one of our student leaders and just said, hey, thanks so much for sharing such a positive and hopeful message in a time that is so chaotic. Friends, like I said, you have people who are waiting to hear the good news of Jesus, who are waiting to hear the ways that you have been redeemed. So my challenge is, don't allow your disappointment to hold you down. But instead, let Jesus redeem that disappointment. Let Jesus change what's happening in your heart and go and spread that to others. So I want to thank you guys so much, like I said, for pressing it, for continuing to see Jesus move in your life. You guys are going to head into small groups now. But yeah, guys, I miss you so much. I can't wait to see my sophomore boys soon. But guys, I love you. We miss you. Can't wait until we're able to join back together. But until then, keep digging into Jesus and keep sharing Jesus with your friends. Thanks so much, guys. We'll see you soon. Bye.